Leo Orlandini is a researcher working at the Institute of Cognitive Sciences and Technologies in Rome, the ISVC-CNR. He got a degree in computer science engineering and he received his PhD in 2006, defending the thesis logical-based approaches to artificial intelligence planning and robot control at the Roma Tre University in Rome. His main research interests are on automated planning and model-based robot control. He is currently working within the planning and scheduling team at the ISTC-CNR, studying temporal plane validation and execution problem in some research projects funded by the European Commission and the European Space Agency. He is also leading the RTD activities on context recognition and capability assessment within the Factory of the Future flagship project framework in the Generic Evolutionary Control Knowledge Base Module project funded by the Italian Research Ministry, the MIUR. Am I right? Did I say correctly?
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
So it's 2:05, so I leave the stage to you, Andrea. Thank you.
Thanks for the very kind presentation, and I would welcome everybody and thanking all of you for attending the lecture. And this is a lecture about automated planning and scheduling with a specific focus on the issues related to the development of robust and dependable systems that leverage this kind of technology. Of course, this is a work that I made in my past years, and I'm still working on also with other people. And it is worth to mention the collaboration with Amedeo Cesta, Marta Cialdea, and Alessandro Umbrico, that are colleagues of mine working in Rome as well. I will give you just a few words about the institute in which I'm working. The CNR is the National Research Council of Italy, the main public research center in Italy. And I'm working in the institute that investigates the connection between cognitive science and technology. In the institute, we have researchers covering many fields spanning from human cognition to cognitive technologies to artificial intelligence. We are a reference institution for cognitive science in Italy and one of the leading institutions in artificial intelligence in the world. There are several research areas, main research areas. The most relevant for the talk of today is about AI, robotics, and in general ICT, potentially any ICT application developed with AI problem-solving techniques. I would underscore the excellence in the Institute about AI research because we host 3 URI fellows on key AI fields such as theory of multi-agent systems, ontology foundations, and AI planning. We have currently one of the recent ERC project winner in a project addressing neuroscience basis for studying the human planning process. We have, of course, we are part of the Taylor network and also of another project funded within the same call, the Human AI project, within the AI initiative promoted by the European Commission. And Amedeo Cesta, one of the colleagues, actually the leader of the group in which I'm working, is also the national contact point for the AI for EU project. And of course, we have also many other activities in the institution. About the group in which I'm working, the Planning and Scheduling Technology Laboratory, we have, in particular, a main focus on AI research. We have a strong experience in problem-solving techniques for scheduling. We have a very large record of working, planning, execution, and integration with verification and validation techniques. And we are very interested in deploying and studying the application of these technologies, of this kind of research, in interactive and user-adaptive systems, leveraging the AI to deal with the to entail a sort of flexibility in the behavior of the system. We have deployed a lot of intelligent systems in real environments, in particular with in human robot and human computer interaction scenarios. And we have some main application areas in which we made some work, in particular in the decision support for space missions. We have a very long collaboration with the European Space Agency about this. We have a rather long experience also in ambient assisted living, developing intelligent software and robotic solutions for supporting elderly people living alone at home. And since more or less 10 years from now, we are developing also activities investigating the use of AI planning in the manufacturing context, and in particular in human robot collaboration scenarios. This is just to provide you with a picture of the activities that we carried out for the European Space Agency. We had a long series of funded project by the agency, and basically our group is an international leadership, has an international leadership in planning, in developing planning software for on-ground mission operations. We started supporting the agency with the Mars Express mission in taking care of managing and controlling a satellite orbiting around the Mars planet, and then we developed several software to support the decision making on the ground segment, and finally we are working on the support of the ExoMars project for the realization of the control architecture for the European Mars rover that will be deployed in the next years. Then here, another picture of the timeline in ambient assisted living context. We have several.
Sorry, Andrea, yes? But we see only the first slide. I don't know how many slides you move on, but ouch, we see only the title.
Oh, this is bad. Let me try to stop sharing and resharing again.
Okay.
You now see my presentation moving?
Yeah.
Okay. So sorry about that.
No, I'm sorry. I only be aware of that right now.
Okay. So this is the slide about the institute. So you have listened. So you know what I said is about the research areas of the institute and the highlights in AI research. Then this is for the group with the information about what we did in research and our interest in deploying actual systems in real environments. And I was showing this timeline of the projects with the European Space Agency. So you can see distribution of projects. We started on the left in the early 2000 in working on the Mars Express. And then we had several projects. And in the last part, since 10 years from now, actually, we started working in the ExoMars project, so in the robotic Mars rover for the Mars exploration. And now I was showing actually this slide about the ambient assisted living. This is actually only a selection of the projects that we had in this area, because these are the ones in which robots were involved. And we had national and international projects. Now we are working on a very big national project funded by the Ministry of University and Research. And in all these activities, we deployed planning and scheduling as one of the key technology in order to provide robotic systems with flexible and adaptive behaviors. And indeed, the technology that I would present you today is the temporal planning and execution with uncertainty. So to understand what does it mean, planning and execution, and provide you an overview of this area. A generic AI system, you may know that is composed by several components. Usually, you have an artificial system that has some sensors to perceive the environment and the other actors that are moving around the agent. There is a reasoning and decision-making module that is in charge of taking care of receiving the perceptions, reason about this, translate this perception in a set of actions in order to achieve some specific or some given goals, and control the actuators that are supposed to interact in the environment. In AI, there are many different approaches. One of the most known currently approach now is the machine learning approach, but these, more in general, can be considered as a machine reasoning. And in particular, you may look at this sort of map of AI areas. And planning and scheduling is one of the sub-area in the reasoning macro area about considering a problem, so considering a goal that is given to an artificial agent, for instance, building an aircraft. Then the planning phase is to generate a plan, a sequence of action, a set of tasks that, if executed, can achieve the goal. And scheduling is to find the right order, so to decide when exactly execute the task that were planned in order to satisfy, for instance, resource constraints, temporal constraints, or whatever operational constraints that you may have in dealing with the big goal that has been assigned to you. In this sense, the planning problem is to provide an answer to the question, how can I achieve a goal starting from some initial situation? So I may have an initial situation, a building with a very bad situation. I have to make some planning, so find some actions that can translate the initial situation in the final situation. So what I'm desiring, which is the goal that has been assigned to me. Planning is usually working considering a model that is representing a domain theory, so the representation of how the environment, the system is working, introducing cause-effect relations of the world, and so providing the planning agent, the planner, the ability to think and reason about how the world works. Then, given a specific goal, the planner is supposed to make a plan as a network of tasks that are what I need to do in order to change the initial situation to the final situation, to achieve the goal. As for scheduling, the problem is, okay, I have a plan, someone already provided me with a plan, so I know what to do, but I have to decide when I must start each activity and how I should be sure that I will respect the limitations that are imposed by time and resource availability, for instance. So in this sense, I have a task network, I have some resources that are useful for implementing my task. I have to produce a schedule, so an ordered sequence of tasks over time that will respect the requirements of on resources and will implement correctly the original plan. Usually in scheduling, we have the knowledge about the constraints, temporal or resource mainly, but in general, any constraints that can be set on a specific problem. And the scheduling result is a set of start and end times that satisfies all the temporal and resource consumption constraints, staying, for instance, within some given bounds. And this is just a very, let's say, general description of the planning and scheduling problem. The application of planning and scheduling in a specific situation in a coupled way allows to have some advantages, because you may have planning approach and scheduling approach. Addressing the problems in a decoupled way allow you to solve the problem, but also usually entails missing some opportunities for having for instance, a better plan and a better schedule, or in another way, to have something that can be brittle, let's say, during the actual execution of the system, of the plan, sorry. In this sense, we are pursuing a planning approach that is called timeline-based planning, that constitutes a viable and effective approach. It was developed in the States in the early 90s, in order to integrate planning and scheduling, temporal planning and scheduling, in order to effectively address both the problems in a unique way. Timeline-based planning took inspiration from control theory and is modeling a system that should be executed, considering a set of features that are described in terms of temporal behaviors, possible temporal behaviors over time. And the planning process is a process that constrain the behavior of the features in order to produce exactly the desired behaviors that guarantee the achievement of the goal. In this sense, planning and scheduling is implemented as a timeline synthesis generation process. This is a picture of a possible timeline-based planning, timeline-based plan, in which, in this case, this is to represent a space rover. So you may have a mobile robot endowed with a camera, a pan tilt unit, a navigation module, a communication system, and there is also a remote orbiter where the robot is supposed to communicate the information acquired by the camera to the orbiter via the communication system. In this sense, you can see that all the features, the camera, the pan tilt, the robot base, communication, etc., are producing over time an evolution of values of activities actually that corresponds to actual actions implemented in the system, in this case in the rover, and the change of values represent the actual activation or deactivation of a specific task on the robot. You see that the robot is supposed to take a picture in a specific location, moving the pan tilt, so orienting the camera in a specific direction, moving and reach the position, the desired position, and then after that the picture has been taken, the communication is started to communicate the information to the orbiter. This is just to provide you with a flavor of what does it mean a timeline-based plan. The arrows between the different features are representing constraints that you need to enforce in your plan in order to be sure that the whole system is working in a correct way. So, for instance, when the robot is moving, is going to a specific location, the pointed unit should be still in a specific orientation, a sort of rest position. If you are communicating, the orbiter should be visible because the orbiter is supposed to orbit around a planet, and so it may be visible or not visible. You can communicate only when the orbiter is visible, and so on. You can represent any kind of constraints in this sense. Some historical issues. This approach has been developed mainly in the United States, but also in the European countries, in some European countries. And in this sense, we have a sort of lack of uniform characterization of the timeline-based approach. We had many different interpretations and implementations of the approach, of the framework. And then there was a sort of confusion about what is actually a timeline, which are the main concept, planning concept to be considered, and so on. Also, maybe this is also a consequence of the first point, there was a lack of methodology for modeling and solving timeline-based problems. Different approaches, so different ways for generating the plans, the solving plans, and also different ways of considering the features of the systems, what to be modeled, how to be model things, etc. And finally, maybe the most important thing about the actual deployment of this kind of systems, a lack in approaching the planning and execution problem under uncertainty. So when you have to deploy an actual planning and scheduling system in real conditions, you need to deal with the unpredictability or the uncontrollability of the systems that you must control. And in this sense, planning and execution should be robust also with respect to such uncertainties. In this sense, we at CNR, but this is rather general results in the planning community, we achieved some research results providing a formal characterization for the timeline-based approach, constituting then a uniform framework for planning and execution, considering also the uncertainty conditions. And in order to provide more robust and dependable solutions based on this technology, we also made some work in integrating planning techniques and technology with the knowledge reasoning and also knowledge engineering, more in general, work. We applied these technologies in real-world human-robot interaction scenarios, assistive robotics, human-robot collaboration, and reconfigurable manufacturing systems. In general, we had a good deployment and an effective integration in the real-world systems. So now I will give a very, let's say, brief, but not so brief actually, introduction of the formalization of flexible timelines. So in the formalization of the timeline-based planning. When we talk about timeline-based planning, we should start on in defining the domain theory, so the description of the environment or the system, and which are the goals that we may define in our system, for our system. We can define then the concept of flexible plans, so plans that are temporally flexible in order to be more robust in the execution condition, and taking care of representing temporal relations among the different components of the domain theory. We also made an effort in order to include in the domain theory the controllability issues that were not addressed at planning level before, distinguishing between controllable and uncontrollable decisions. And I will say more in the next slides. To introduce the concept, I will use an example, a remote satellite domain that basically is actually derived from a real project that we developed with the European Space Agency. So you may imagine a remote satellite that is orbiting around a remote planet. The satellite can point to the remote planet and has some payloads, some instruments to produce scientific data. And the satellite can point to the Earth in order to communicate with some ground station, ground communication station. So performing some downlinking activity for communicating the scientific data gathered from the scientific activity. There is a set of operative constraints that must be satisfied. So only pointing to the planet, is it possible to have observations, scientific observations? Pointing to Earth is necessary in order to transmit data to the ground stations. Communicate is possible only if the ground station is visible, because as you know, planets are following complex rules and visibility may be not available in some periods of time. And finally, there is the need of performing some maintenance operations from time to time. So we can describe the planning domain, the domain theory, considering some main features that will be called state variables, a way for representing the main feature of the system to be controlled. The domain specification, so the domain theory, will be composed by a set of state variables and a set of constraints that we will call synchronization, in order to synchronize the evolution, the temporal evolution of the different state variables. In this sense, we then will receive some goals that must be achieved, and the goals are represented as some desired temporal behavior of one or more of the state variables representing the features of the system. We are in the next slides, I will consider a discrete time framework, but our formal approach allows also to consider real time, so a continuous time framework for the framework. A state variable, the basic component of the domain theory, is a tuple composed by, a name, a set of values, a value transition function, a controllability tagging function in order to set which values of the state variables are actually controllable or uncontrollable. The controllability is whether we can actually decide the exact duration of the task, or the duration is outside the control of the planning agent, but it's something that is up to the environment. So it's something that is outside the control of the planning engine. There is also a duration function that is used to state which is the minimal and maximal temporal duration for each values in the state variable. And this is the description of a simple state variable. This is the specification for the satellite example. So for the satellite example, we consider, of course, this is one possible model. It's not the unique model. So this is an example. we may consider two different state variables, a pointing mode state variable and a ground station visibility state variable. You can see here, you have the values, the transition function, the controllability tag, the duration, etc. This is in the lower part of the slide. You have the pointing mode state variable and the ground station visibility state variable. The arrows are encoding the possible transition between a value to another one. The numbers within the brackets are stating the duration, the minimal and the maximal duration. In this case, you have different values, so you have an interval, a temporal interval within the activity is must be. And the orange elements are the ones that are under that are outside the control of the planning engine, so are the uncontrollable elements of the domain theory. In this sense, the communication is the duration of the communication activity, for instance, is outside the control of the planning engine, because it depends on the size of the data that you need to communicate. There are some bounds, but you cannot, the planning engine cannot decide which is the exact duration. So in this sense, all the plans generated for these problems, for this kind of problems, must deal with all the possibility that can be extracted from these temporal bounds. So you need to deal with this kind of uncertainty. And if a state variable like this one is completely uncontrollable, we will call it an external state variable, because this is something that is external to the control of the planning agent, but is something that we can only observe. This is something that we can check, we can perceive from the environment, but we cannot decide anything about the evolution of this feature of the system. To state the possible relation, the possible constraints between the values and the state variables, we introduce some temporal relations with some bounds. So we consider different temporal relations that put some relations between intervals. So I may put in relation, for instance, the start time of a value of an interval with the start time of another interval, with also some temporal distance. Or I can consider some temporal relations between an interval and a time point in my temporal evolution. Again, considering so the distance between the start or the end time of a specific interval and a time t specified in the relation. In general, we can consider any kind of Allen qualitative temporal relations. You may know about the Allen's algebra about temporal relations. So you can state constraints like make something during some other thing is running, or an interval that is containing another interval, some intervals that is before or after another one, and so on. So there is an algebra specified by Allen's about these kind of temporal constraints. We can leverage these temporal relations in order to specify the synchronization rules, in order to synchronize the different state variables in our domain theory. So, for instance, going back again to the satellite example, if we want to say that the satellite communicates with Earth only when the ground station is visible, then we can put some logical formula in order to state that there is a known fact that implies some constraints. In this sense, exactly representing this kind of constraints, when we have an interval with the value com, so communicating in the pointing mode state variable, then there will be on the ground station visibility state variable an interval with the visible value, and this interval will be in contains relation. So this means that the communication should be within the visible interval with respect to the communication. So there is here two constraints to state that the start and the end times of the intervals should be in contains in a temporal constraints relationship. If you don't have a precedence, if you have no head in your synchronization, then you can use it for stating some knowing facts. So for instance, you may state the initial condition of your problem. In this case, you say that whatever is the head on the pointing mode state variable, earth will be the initial value. So you see the start is in 0, 0 with the time point 0, and 0 is the origin of our temporal axis. So in this sense, you can state a initial situation in your state variables, or you can use it to state the goals. So you can use it also to state the goals for your planning agent. Once we have defined the state variables and the synchronization, we can start building our solution. So the timeline that will constitute the solution of our planning problem. We start defining what is called a flexible token, that is a decision basically about a specific state variable that assign to the state variable a specific value within the one of the state variable, put some temporal constraints. Now I will avoid to go into detail, but these two brackets are stating the end time and the duration of the flexible token. So you have something that is not fixed, but the duration and the end time are represented by temporal interval. So in this sense, there is a sort of flexible duration and then a sort of flexible uncertainty about the actual temporal execution of the token. And there is, of course, a controllability tag that is the same stated for the state variable. So if the value is controllable, the flexible token will be controllable. In case the value is uncontrollable, the flexible token will result as uncontrollable. A timeline, a flexible timeline for a state variable, is a sequence of flexible tokens, of ordered flexible tokens, so starting from x0 to xk, with k any number, integer number. And we fix a temporal horizon because we want to have a timeline, so a plan, a sequence of tasks covering from the origin of the time, so x0 we start in 0, 0, and reach the temporal horizon, so covering, spanning all the relevant horizon that must be addressed by our temporal plan. For external state variables, the timeline, of course, contains only uncontrollable tokens, while the normal timeline will have controllable or uncontrollable tokens. I would underscore the concept of flexibility here. You don't have a fixed temporal plan, but you have, in a flexible timeline, you have actually a set of possible temporal plans. So we usually say that a flexible timeline is actually representing an envelope of non-flexible timeline. Here you can see an example. This is a flexible timeline, and you see that, again, for the satellite domain, you can see that there is a sequence of values from 0, 0 to some specified horizon. The pink intervals are representing the uncertainty, the flexible interval in which the planning engine may or may not choose when to change the value of the timeline, and so how to change the value of the state variable representing a feature of the system. Here you have a flexible timeline with several temporal intervals, and below you see one possible instance that we call a projection. So the projection is a possible instance of a flexible timeline. So actually the flexible timeline is representing a set, an envelope of projections that are representing all the possible schedules of the flexible timeline. In this sense, an instance is a projection that is valid with respect to the planning domain. So it's something that is valid with respect to the timeline, but is also guaranteeing the achievement of the constraints. And let's say that, okay, this is again an information about what is the a flexible plan, but the main point here is that you cannot rely only on the information of the flexible timeline. A flexible plan will be a set of flexible timelines, but you need something more, because you have this envelope of possible behaviors, and you need also a set of relations among tokens in the timelines in order to enforce the constraints defined by the synchronization. So the flexible plan will be actually represented by a pair with a set of flexible timelines, one for each state variable in our domain theory, and a set of temporal relations among tokens describing all the information that we required in order to solve the problem, so to solve the planning problem, but also to solve the execution problem, so to schedule the activities in a way that is viable for having an actual and effective execution of the temporal plan. This is an example to demonstrate why we actually need these temporal relations in addition to the flexible timelines information. So here you can see there is an example about a good plan that must satisfy a synchronization rule. So the synchronization rule is that whenever you find a V value on the state variable X, then there will be in another state variable Y a value V prime that must start when the V value is ending, exactly at the same time. This is a zero distance between X and Y, the V and V prime token, or the V and V prime tokens may be in a after relation, so there may be a distance from 5 to 10 time units between the two tokens. So graphically, this is the situation. You have on the timeline for the state variable X, you have a token V, And in on the timeline for the state variable y, you have the token v prime. The pink intervals are the start time and the end time intervals in which the two tokens can start or end. Okay, so you may see that I can choose some option. So I can try to look for some instance within these intervals, and you see that I cannot have the situation in which all the options are fine with respect to the synchronization. In this sense, for instance, the dark blue interval is not respecting the synchronization with respect to the red interval. So the V and V prime, the V and V prime intervals are admissible, the blue and the red are admissible with respect to the state variable, but they are not respecting the synchronization. If I choose in a different way the start time of V prime, so I add to my plan an information, for instance, that the token X should end exactly at the start time of the token Y, J, then I have a flexible plan, an instance of my flexible plan that is respecting the constraints given by the synchronization. I may have also another solution that is valid. In this case, I choose a different start time for the V prime token. And again, there is the timeline, the flexible timeline, and the temporal relations. In this case, I put this distance, temporal distance between X and Y, and I have another possible projection that is valid with respect to the synchronization. This provides so advantages, because rather than having a fixed plan, I have a flexible plan, so I have an envelope of planning solutions, and this is good, because when I will address the execution of my plan, I will have more opportunities in order to execute my plan. So if I add one fixed time for executing, for instance, for starting a specific activity, if I miss this opportunity, my plan is broken and I need to replan from scratch my plan. Instead, in this case, if I add more opportunities for choosing the temporal instant in which I have to start or to end a token, then I have more opportunities, and if I miss one of them, hopefully I will have many others to maintain the validity of my flexible plan. And this is the good part of the thing. The bad part is that executing this kind of plans is not trivial, because you need to have an executor, an executive system, that is capable of dealing with the complexity of managing a flexible plan and the relations, and to make the right choice in order to keep the control of the system. Because you may recall that not all the tokens in my plan are controllable. So in case that the V prime token is uncontrollable, so I cannot decide when to start or when to end the V prime token, then my planning engine, actually my executive engine, should choose in the right way the V start or end time, because otherwise I will fail in having a good solution for all the possible uncontrollable evolution of the V prime token. And this is exactly what has been defined as the controllability problem for timeline-based planning execution. The executor, so the executive system in charge of executing the flexible plan, must take decisions on when exactly a given activity must start or end, so when tokens must be activated or deactivated. And if we reason on this domain theory, we can act, the executive system can only act on the controllable part of the model. So we need to define a set of controllability properties that guarantees that we can keep the control of the flexible temporal plan. This is something that we made leveraging some theoretical work made by some people in the States, in particular at NASA. They made a similar reasoning with the simple temporal networks with uncertainty. They made this with the temporal network because the temporal network is the main structure that was used, actually is used to represent timeline-based plans. So in the States at NASA, they made this effort of considering controllability issues in the temporal network with uncertainty. This is good, but was not so good, or at least not enough, because the planning phase and the scheduling phase, so when you actually produce the temporal plan, you don't keep in mind the uncontrollable part of the problem. You introduce and decide the uncontrollable, you deal with the uncontrollable part of your problem only when you address the execution problem with the temporal networks. And indeed, the NASA software working on timeline-based planning was actually executing the temporal networks. So simple temporal networks with uncertainty were used in order to represent the plans, and this structure was actually executed by the system. We thought that this was not, let's say, elegant, but it was also more effective to consider the uncontrollability also in the planning specification. And so we introduced this formalization that I presented you in the past slides, and having the flexible plan, we distinguish between the controllable tokens and the uncontrollable tokens, and we can define a relations between the temporal networks and the flexible timelines. We leverage this relation in order to define similar concepts like in the temporal networks, also for the flexible timeline. So we consider situations as possible evolutions of the uncontrollable part of the plan. So you may think about situation like all the possible evolution of your plan that is outside the control of the planning agent. So all the situations are representing how things can go wrong in your plan. So something that is outside your control. And we state that omega, capital omega, is the set of all situations. So the capital omega for a flexible timeline-based plan is the set of all the possible contingencies that you may have in executing your plan. A projection is a fully controllable evolution of the flexible plan. So, which is the game? The game is finding a projection that is valid and that is working with any possible situation of your plan. So the projection is the controllable part of your plan, and the situation, all the set of situations, are the uncontrollable part of your plan. So we need to find a way to have a projection for any possible situation in our plan. To do this, we need a scheduling function So theta, we call it theta, a function that given the tokens in the controllable part of the flexible plan, provide a time for executing the tokens. And all the set of the scheduling functions is denoted by capital T, and we say that the scheduling function for a flexible plan is consistent if and only if the scheduled timelines induced by theta are an instance of the plan, so are valid with respect to the domain theory. In this sense, the goal for the execution of the plan is to find an execution strategy. The execution strategy is a function that, for any situation, provide a schedule that is viable. So here we are saying that whatever is the uncontrollable evolution of the plan, and then the uncontrollable evolution of my system, I have a valid schedule for my plan that keep the control of the system. And we will say that this is viable if, for each situation, the scheduling function provide a schedule that is consistent with the plan. Okay? There is many theoretical work here, but I would synthesize this in a very short way. And basically, we can define different. Sorry, a moment, please. An uncontrollable part of my house was starting the vacuum robots just behind me. So sorry about that. Anyway, I was saying that apart the all the theoretical work that is here in defining this kind of properties, we can say that a flexible plan can have different kind of controllability. It can be weakly controllable, and this means that we have one possible viable execution strategy. But this is weak because actually this is working for at least one possible situation. So if we are lucky in our execution of the plan, we will meet exactly that situation, and then we can succeed in executing the plan. But we cannot guarantee that we have a strategy for all the possible situations, just for at least one situation. A strongly controllable plan means that we have one viable execution strategy that will work for any situation. So we don't mind about which situation is actually in front of our system, but executing this execution strategy that is strongly controllable, we will succeed in the execution. So it's like having a set of instructions. You can close your eyes, follow the instruction, exactly the set of instruction given to you, and you are sure that will achieve your goal. This is something that, of course, is very robust, but it's also very difficult to synthesize, because not all the planning problems, in particular the one with highly high dynamic evolution in the system, can be guaranteed to have a strongly controllable execution strategy. And finally, the most interesting strategy properties better is the dynamically controllable plans. This means that there is a dynamic execution strategy, so a strategy that keep decision only considering past uncontrollable events. So at each time during the execution of your plan, you take decision, the execution strategy, the DES strategy, provide you with a decision only considering what was happened in the past. It does not make any assumption on what is going to happen in the near future. So the dynamic controllability is the more interesting and highly desirable property because it guarantees robust plan execution, but also guarantees to maintain all the possible opportunities to have, for instance, an optimal plan execution. So it's a sort of least commitment approach to plan execution, to temporal plan execution. Okay. And we made an effort for connecting formal methods to planning and execution techniques. So leveraging this formal framework for timeline-based planning, and we implemented a technique to synthesize plan controllers leveraging model checking techniques. How we made it? We use timed game automata that are a formalism to describe timed behaviors with controllable and uncontrollable actions. So you have an automata with a set of locations, a set of transitions with temporal constraints. You may define invariants, guards on the transitions, and many other constraints. You can distinguish between controllable and uncontrollable transitions. So the right arrow and the dotted arrows are representing respectively controllable and uncontrollable transitions. There is a way for using this formalism in order to synthesize strategy. A strategy is a partial mapping between the possible temporal evolutions of an automata, of a TGA, and the set of actions that are controllable, plus one special action that is called lambda. The lambda action is actually an action that states just wait and do nothing. So this is something that is let the time passing and wait for the good moment to make some controllable action. And this is something, a formalism that has been introduced by some theoretical computer scientists, and we leverage this formalism implementing this metaphor. The player is the plan controller, and the opponent is the environment, because time game automata are basically representing a game between a player that is endowed with the controllable action and an opponent that is endowed with uncontrollable actions. The goal, so the game, is to reach some specific location, and for the opponent is to avoid that we reach our goal location and make it, for instance, the automata evolving in a different way. So we say that the player is the plan controller, the part that is controllable in our plan, and the opponent is the environment, what is outside our control. We implemented a method in order to encode flexible timeline plans in a network of time game automata. So we translate our planning and scheduling execution problem in a set of automata, and we define a reachability game. So we define a reachability game on this network, and we demonstrate that winning the game implies first verifying the plan. So the plan is correct with respect to the domain theory. And then also checking the dynamic controllability property. So if it is possible to win the game, we can say that the plan is dynamically controllable. Then, using a model checker developed by the Uppsala and Aalborg University, UPAL TIGA, that is the TIGA is a variation of the classical UPAL model checker. We used this verification engine in order to actually synthesize the winning strategy and then translate the strategy produced by TIGA, by UPAL TIGA, in a plan controller for the flexible timeline-based plan. Okay, so we made this result possible. And then we find a way to have a robust execution of our plan, also preserving the dynamic controllability, of course, when the plan can be dynamically controllable. This is not always the case, of course. We integrated this approach, this methodology, in the software that we were developing at the time. The APSI deliberative reactor is one of the reasoning engine running on the ExoMars prototype at the European Space Agency. Here we have the planning software, our planning software, planning and scheduling software that was developed several years ago, again for the Space Agency. The plan execution part, so with the dispatching services and the execution feedback services, were replaced with another set of services that were leveraging the UPAL TIGA software, and then was able to translate the planning specification in a time game automata, and leveraging UPAL TIGA and the winning strategy of the game, translating the winning strategy in a controller strategy for the flexible plan execution, and then realizing a robust execution of the flexible plans generated by the APSI software. This was a very important achievement in the software development that we made for the European Space Agency, of course. And later, some years ago, more or less 5 or 6 years ago, we deployed a different approach, a more lightweight approach to address the same problem. And basically, we started considering not all the information related to the domain theory and the flexible plan, but we leverage the fact that the flexible plan contains all the information that we need in order to execute the plan. So we translate only the flexible plan, so the flexible timelines and the temporal relations, in the network of time game automata, and we apply the same method, again with UPAL TIGA, in order to demonstrate that we can have a correspondence between the winning game, the winning strategy, and the check of dynamic controllability and the generation of viable dynamic execution strategy. We implemented also a tool that is called Plan2TIGA that made, sorry, that made this this encoding for the specific planning engine. And here is the website when you can download this tool. We realize then another tool that is actually implementing all this loop. And this has been deployed in a specific planning engine that we developed in our laboratory. The idea is to connect the strategy manager, the idea is to connect the strategy manager to the UPAL TIGA again, but with a more effective deployment, so having a more robust and effective results. basically, this slide was to demonstrate that we actually put at work in a more effective way the same approach deployed in the APSI software, the space agency software. And we have effective in the sense of temporal performances, so we in computation time with respect to the other approach that we deployed in the older software framework. And this was deployed in our current software framework that we deployed in several real world applications. So let's say that the robustness of execution is actually one part of what is actually needed in order to be sure that a planning agent is actually robust and dependable. To talk about dependability, we need something more than just robust execution. Dependability is actually a property that has been defined for, let's say, software services. And the property can be described as the ability of a system to avoid failures that are more frequent or severe, and outage durations that are longer than is acceptable. So the point is that dependability is the ability of the system to be robust with respect to some acceptable conditions. So it's fine if the system is failing, is having a failure, or is out of service for some periods, but not more or not longer than some acceptable threshold. The resilience is basically the persistence of the services delivery. So this is, let's say, something that is relevant with respect to the services, but resilience is also the way of facing possible evolutions of different scenarios. So this is in static conditions, let's say, so the system is always facing the same conditions, while the resilience is a stronger property, ensuring dependability, but when facing different conditions, different changing conditions. There was an effort in the European community, fostered by the European Commissions, in order to define what does it mean to develop trustworthy artificial intelligence applications. And in 2018, a set of experts appointed by the Commission defined a draft, an initial document stating which are the ethical guidelines for developing trustworthy AI. And among the seven key requirements for ethical AI, there is also technical robustness and safety. And this is something that is connected to the robustness that I presented you for the execution of temporal flexible plan. But actually, technical robustness is more than that. Is not just to be robust when executing a plan. It's also to take into account a set of potential situations in which the system may harm, for instance, the user. If you are deploying an AI planning system in which the system is supposed to interact with the human users, you may have a risky situation, and you want to be sure to have a really dependable system. You want to be sure that the system avoids any harm to the human user. So you need to have some reliable technology, and you have to demonstrate also that your system is actually robust, it is reliable, is secure, and in the few words defined by this commission, you have a trustworthy application of AI in your system. Okay, so these are the dependability and resilience property. The challenge is to build robust planning and scheduling systems from my perspective. So in order to address this problem, we were investigating, and we actually are investigating, the possible connection between verification and validation and planning and scheduling autonomy. In fact, there are many planning and scheduling systems that are deployed in safety critical situations, but the tools and methodologies for verification and validation of planning and scheduling system have received, let's say, a relatively little attention. So there are, in our opinion at least, there are many opportunities for having good deployment, good and effective deployment of formal methods in planning and scheduling. And what I presented before, the execution, the robust execution through model checking, is something that is witnessing these potentialities. So what is verification and validation? Verification is a process to address the question, are we building the thing right? So are we making the thing in the correct way? What we are producing is correct. While validating, the validation phase is addressing the question, are we building the right thing? So are we actually doing what the user really expects? Are we doing the system that is really addressing the problem that we need to solve, or are we developing something that is different? So is solving a different problem. So it's correct, but addressing a different problem. So these are the two main questions for verification and validation. In a generic plan-based controller system, you have the domain theory, and the problem is also part of the domain theory. Then you have a planner that, having as input the domain theory, can generate a plan, a solution plan for our problem. Then there is an executive system that is taking the plan and executing the plan in the actual system, in the plant that should be controlled. There is an execution trace produced by the executive, and a monitor, another process, is comparing the feedback, the actual feedback from the plant with respect to the expected execution trace. So if the plant and the execution trace are consistent, the execution is proceed in a good way. If there is a difference between the feedback and the execution trace, then something is going wrong. The execution is not effective, is not successful. And then, in case, we need to redefine the problem, because there is a different situation, and the planner should start again a loop of planning and execution for controlling the system. In this generic architecture, we may have problems with the model that maybe fails to capture the behavior of the system to be controlled. So the model is describing something different or not properly correct with respect to the actual behavior of the plant. The planner is a software. Being a software means having bugs or failure or semantic failure. Something in a model is interpreted in a different, in the wrong way. The plan may be executed, but it may be that there are some mismatch between the plan, the actual action in the plan, and the actual execution of the plan. So the semantics between the action in the plan and the actual activation signal sent to the system is different. There is some mismatch in this way. And finally, the physical system may have some feedback, because their behaviors are unexpected or there is some spurious event that lead to an inconsistency between the feedback and the execution trace. Everywhere here, we need verification and validation. We need some verification and validation to apply these techniques in order to figure out the presence of errors. And with the formal methods, we can also demonstrate, in some cases, we can demonstrate that errors are present or absent, or at least we can demonstrate that we can find a robust solution, something that is dependable, that is reliable in this sense. We leverage this approach of exploiting model checking with time game automata in several research projects. Ulisse was a research project that was funded by the European Commission, and was about the deployment of planning in a module of the International Space Station. We produce a demonstrator using our technology for increment planning, so for a 3 month period of the Columbus module on the space station, and we deployed a plan verification and validation tool leveraging the game automata approach to demonstrate that the temporal plans generated by our planner were correct with respect to the domain model. So the plan were actually executing describing the actions, the sequence of action to be executed in the correct way. Then in a project funded by the European Space Agency, the one about the ExoMars prototype, we deployed the deliberative layer based on our timeline-based planning and execution technology. And we used our software and our methods to deploy a plan controller synthesis approach using time game automata controllers. So translating flexible plans in time game automata and using Upaltiga to synthesize the plan controllers. In our work, we go also beyond these applications. And indeed, we were addressing more general issues related to knowledge engineering, because we believe that the deployment of AI planning tool, but actually this is something that holds for any AI tool and AI techniques, there is the need of having some tools or some ways for easing the deployment of this technology. In some sense, we need to have a wide and huge diffusion of AI solutions. We need to make it easier for people that are not experienced or even beginner in the usage of AI techniques, for instance, in the domain design of from a planning perspective. We need some knowledge engineer that should state which is the domain theory of our problem. So we cannot make it very simple if we don't provide users that may have no prior knowledge about AI planning in encoding their problems, so being domain expert, and being able to use these techniques. If you need an AI expert to have a system running in your company, in your plant, then this means that you have a barrier in the level in developing your AI techniques and tools. So we made an effort in integrating in a more tight way verification and validation in our planning and scheduling system. Considering domain issues, so domain design and definition, considering the plan, so verifying the plan and validating the plan with respect to the requirements, and in general, integrating methodology, verification and validation, and planning and scheduling in order to address these issues. The result of this effort was what we have called the KEEN design support system. That was KEEN stands for Knowledge Engineering Environment, where we leveraged, this is for the ESA software, but is holding also for the for any timeline-based planning software. We leverage the encoding in time game automata in order to implement different knowledge engineering functions. So domain validation, planner validation, plan execution validation, and controller synthesis. In addition, we developed the usual knowledge engineering functions like editing and visualization of the domain and the problem, and editing and visualization of flexible plans. Using the Upaltiga engine, we were able to implement model checking to realize verification and validation functions and provide a framework that can be deployed to make the system, the AI system, easier in defining the domain theory and more robust and dependable in deploying the solutions generated by the software, the planning and scheduling software. We applied this approach also in robotic environments, in robotic application, and we considered this approach in which we have basically different experts working at different abstraction layers. So we have a domain expert that is in charge of defining the task and the goal of a robotic application. So you may imagine the production engineer in a shop floor that wants to apply robotics in order to produce some goods. On the other side, you have an AI planning expert that is in charge of translating this specification in a set of planning specification in heuristics and planning algorithms to generate the plans to be executed by a robotic platform. And finally, you have a robotic platform expert that is in charge of configuring the robot, implementing all the low-level functionalities, low-level in the sense of actually controlling, physically controlling the robots, and executing the tasks, the actions generated by the planning system to achieve the tasks and the goal defined by the domain expert. Each expert is not supposed to have expertise in AI or in robotic or other fields. So everybody should be able to contribute in a whole knowledge engineering process to realize an effective application of AI and robotics in a specific domain. But we may not expect, we should not expect that an expert, in particular the domain expert, should be expert also of AI and robotics. The domain expert wants to have his problem solved, and he doesn't want to study AI planning or robotics in order to do this. He wants something easy to use for having AI and robotic solution at work. We have presented a work 2 years ago in the International Conference on Robot and Human Interactive Communication about a tool to facilitate the interaction between AI and robotic experts. And this year, we made another presentation about a way for providing also domain expert with some easy to use tool in order to define their problem and having an automatic translation of the domain definition in a planning specification to be executed on a robot. So you may refer, I will leave the reference also to investigating some additional issues with respect to the talk. And now I will conclude. We have deployed all these research in real scenarios. We made an effort to develop a software that we call Platinum. This is an evolution, a novel version of the software that we developed for the European Space Agency. And we developed this software in order to apply this technology, the planning and execution technology, in human-robot collaboration scenarios. We deployed these in two European EU-funded projects, the 4x3 that was ended 3 years ago, and the ShareWork project that is running now. And this video is showing an interaction, actually a collaboration, between an operator and a robotic arm, a collaborative robotic arm. Here, you may see a graphical representation of the timeline plans, the flexible timeline plans. Some part of the plan is representing what the operator should execute, and another part is representing what the operator is supposed to execute. Of course, the operator part of the plan is uncontrollable because we cannot control the execution of the operator, but we can only ask the operator to make the task. And so this unpredictability is managed by the planning system, maintaining the controllability of the plan. And it was effective in improving also the productiveness of the cell, of the robotic cell. This is almost my last slide. I presented this timeline-based approach for temporal planning with uncertainty. And I also provide a very quick, but actually not so quick, representation of the formalization of timeline-based planning, how to model controllability issues, and how to leverage model checking with time game automata to check controllability and guarantee robust execution. I presented you the advancement that we made in our work about controllability, but also some other advancements about knowledge engineering and verification and validation. I also showed you in the very last slides about the possible experiments that we can make. And now we are working in a project in order to deploy this in a real industrial setting. So in a setting in which the system is operating with real users in a real shop floor. I provided you a list of selected references. Of course, I guess that you will have some way for having the slides. So I will provide, I will put available the slides of this lecture, at least on my website, and so you may have a look to the references. A last word about the fact that we are looking for collaborators and candidates for PhD opportunity. In particular, we are looking for collaborators in European research projects, in particular in collaborative robots and social assistive robotics context. And we are looking for PhD students in embedded AI in human-robot interaction and planning and acting fields. So in case you may be interested, you can contact me. And this is the end of my presentation. I would thank you for your attention. And this is it. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. And do you hear me? Yeah. Thank you so much, Andrea. Is there any question? As usual, you can write in the chat. Mm. Maybe we can wait like 5 minutes, few minutes. In the meanwhile, I would like to ask a question, if I may.
Yeah, of course.
About the integration of these kind of models with social robots. So, yeah. What is the, you know, how does the social model the robot integrates interact with these kind of models? You know, the social model does affect the temporal, you know, the temporal system or.
Yeah, thanks. This is actually this gives me the possibility to have some more words about our research investigation, because actually we use this technology in human robot interaction and also in social interactions. In particular, the social aspects is something that actually involves, let's say, a more complex and more abstract features of AI. In particular, we are investigating the use of semantic technologies and ontologies in particular to provide the robotic system, the artificial systems, with additional knowledge about the user. So providing the planning engine with additional, more abstract knowledge about, for instance, the social attitude of a user. Or in the case, since we are addressing this in assistive scenario, we may have users that have disabilities. In this sense, we can provide, we can leverage this abstract knowledge, we can state in this knowledge the special needs that a user may have. And in this sense, we are investigating the implementation of a dialogue system, to have a dialogue system with the user that have special needs through a social robots. And the planning engine is controlling the communication channels of the robot in order to have an effective interaction, social interaction. So the interaction is basically as dialogue or as the expression, because we are using a social robot that allows to change the eyes expression or the colors. And the idea is to have, in this sense, a dynamic adaptation. So not something that is pre-ordered. So you have, for instance, some rules for the interaction. So you state there these rules and the robot is only to execute the rules. In our view, planning can introduce this flexibility also in the social interaction phase. And then we try to leverage social channels planning, to adapt during the execution and during also, let's say, some rehabilitation process. So not just one interaction, but a long-term interaction in this sense. So to adapt over time the interactions.
So making the system even more robust, if possible.
Also yes.
And okay.
This, of course, yeah. And this opens a lot of issues, because you need to control very complex things, and you need also to take care of ethical issues. You have to deal with the fact that the people maybe doesn't like the user doesn't like robots or whatever. So there are a lot of issues in testing this for real. I see there is a question. Okay, thanks. Okay.
Yeah, the question. Thanks for the
technical standpoint. We can verification validation. Okay, we can verify and validate, I guess. Nevertheless, in terms of space, we must comply with space law. If you mean space, space law, I guess that you are considering the fact of complexity, I guess, because if you If you can talk, it's better. Otherwise, I guess that this is the focus of your question. Verification and validation, I agree that is a very tough process. Applying for real verification and validation in real constant is expensive from a space and computational perspectives. So you have to deal with a high complexity, because you must deal with the space explosion problem. You may have situations in which you cannot afford the complexity of the situation. In our experience, a possible solution, at least the one that we applied when we face real problems, it is to follow a hierarchical approach. A hierarchical approach allows you to have to distribute the complexity of your problem in different levels. So you have a hierarchy of control loops that are connected, and you address the problem at different abstraction levels. So you have a very abstract level in which you have general problems, and then you go down and have more precise, more detailed and limited problems with more specific control approaches. So this is, of course, a workaround. It's not a general solution. But this is something that, in our experience, lead us to have this feasible also in realistic situation, in real-world applications. I hope this is addressing your question.